Guten Morgen, meine Damen und Herren. Es möchte mir viel Spaß, dass wir in unserer Mitte haben Frank Karliczek. That would be about it, because I don't think anyone would appreciate if we would do the entire talk in German. But I'm very proud to have him with us, Frank Karliczek. He was with us already once before, presenting his then very new product, OwnCloud. And today he will present to us the reason that he actually forked his own company, forked his own product, and now has a new product that's called NextCloud. Have fun!
Thanks a lot. Thanks for the warm introduction. It's really nice to be here. And as mentioned before, I was here many, many years ago, and it's really, really great to be back. So, as already mentioned, my name is Frank Karliczek. I'm a free software developer for like over 20 years. It's a bit scary to think about that. That's really a long time. A lot of different projects, did a lot of different initiatives and things. But now I'm invited here as the founder of OwnCloud and founder of NextCloud, a successor. May I ask who knows NextCloud in the audience? Okay, who doesn't know NextCloud? Oh, still a few, okay, great. So I want to talk first a little bit about the idea behind it, why this is relevant, why I'm here in front of an open source IT crowd. And then a little bit of an overview about NextCloud, what we are doing, and then the actual topic of the talk, the history behind it. So I still have I have a lot of slides, but I still want to make it interactive. So always interrupt me, ask questions if you're interested in any specific details. First, I want to talk a little bit about the cloud. I mean, we all know the term cloud, but I don't know how many really know what it really means. I mean, I did a little bit of research for that. I'll show it to you in a second. There is this term you find online that data is the new oil. So this means that, I mean, we all know oil, that's like the stuff that is like running our industry, like our society, a lot of innovation, a lot of stuff really depend on oil. And the theory here is that data is the new oil, which means data is like the stuff that really pushes our society, our industry, everything forward. Really a key ingredient for the future. I looked up a few statistics. I mean, this is the growth of data we see at the moment. And this is just a few years ago. Like if you look back here, like 2013, 14 or something, so little data. Now it's really growing exponentially. It's really crazy. What is this data? It's all kinds of stuff, photos and videos. There's a number of here from like 170 million emails per minute. And it's just crazy amount of data that we're producing all the time. If you look at the Internet of Things, I mean, this is all the connected devices. I mean, in the old days, we all had like one computer maximum, or maybe none, because we used a mainframe or something. Then we had like a personal computer. Nowadays, we're surrounded by computers. Everything is a computer. And all these computers, of course, they produce data. Okay, now you're wondering what happens with all the data. Where is this stored? Where is this processed? And the answer is usually in the cloud. Okay, all the data and all the applications are in the cloud. Okay, great. So what is this cloud thing? Where does the name come from? I did a little bit of research, and I still remember, because I'm old, this kind of diagrams here from the 90s. So this was basically the way where like a company described their architecture, right? This is what they're doing. They have like a fax machine and a telephone and a PC, and it's all connected with cables. And then on the left-hand side, you had this cloud thing here, right? I think this was mainly used because it was a clip art from PowerPoint. So this was mainly used, this symbol here. And what it means was, well, there is more here. I don't really know what it is. It is something. There are definitely some cables and boxes and hard disks there, but I don't know. And I also don't really care. It's not my business. It's not my responsibility, not part of the diagram, but it's definitely connected. It's definitely part of it. It's definitely communicating somehow, but I don't really know what it is. It's magic somehow. This is another diagram where you have another cloud. You have switches and cables and servers. And there's, of course, then again the cloud. This is not my business, somewhere else. And this is the cloud. Of course, nowadays, it would look a little bit different. It would look more like that. Because the cloud is so much bigger now. Like, all the data is in the cloud. All the applications are in the cloud. And the local infrastructure are just a little bit. Like, our smartphone is just a thin client to the cloud. And we have a little bit of terminals and machines here and there. But, like, the cloud is really dominating everything. So if you go back to the term data is the new oil, you can really see that, like, the cloud is like where everything is. The cloud is really important. This is where the data is stored. And I really think you can say that data is the new oil. Okay, so we all know the countries where the oil comes from, right? The oil exporting countries, and we know all the conflicts and all the trouble this caused over the years. And you wonder, okay, where data is the new oil, where is the data stored or produced or controlled? So I had a little bit of work. I took like a world map and like marked all the places where the data is produced and stored, like similar to oil. But it was really quickly done because it looks like that, basically. So this is where the data is stored and controlled at Silicon Valley, basically. Right? You have like Facebook and Google and Dropbox there. And a little bit north, you have then Microsoft and Amazon. But this is really where, like, the data, the foundation of our innovation and society is like stored and controlled. And I don't think this is very healthy. I really think it should be more decentralized. People should be more in control of their data. So the cloud should be something which is not really owned by like four companies or five companies, but really something that's like decentralized and open source. And this is what we want to achieve with Nextcloud. I mean, part of it. It's a big task, of course. But what we want to do and what we are doing is we are providing all these services you know from the cloud in other ways, like contacts and emails and files and videos and chatting and everything and so on, with the key difference that everything we are doing is open source. Right? All the server components are open source. All the client components are open source. Everything is open source. It's HGPL for the server parts and GPL for all the iOS, Android, Mac, Windows, Linux clients. And it, of course, has the advantage that you can run it wherever you want. Right? You can just take it, put it on some infrastructure, and then you have your own little cloud there for your data. This can be for, like, for your family, for like three users at home, or can be like for a big company or for a whole, government or something. Now I want to go a little bit through some functionalities of Nextcloud. I don't want to make this like a big marketing talk here, but I think it might be interesting to know what we are doing. So if you log in into the web interface, the first thing is you see something like that. It's basically like a file manager in the browser. You can have all your files there, upload and download your files and share them and search them and tag them and all the usual stuff. You can extend like a sidebar, where it can then see versions of a file and comment on a file and chatting around a file and all the stuff you want to do with your data, with your files, basically. We did a little bit more in the latest version we released 4 weeks ago. We introduced some machine learning features where you can like recommendations, maybe here on top, recommendations about files you use or recommendations of people you want to share with here. So a little bit of machine learning, neural networking here. But again, everything on your machine, everything locally. Nothing is in the public cloud. Everything is in the private cloud here. Of course, a lot of people never really use this web interface because they always use the clients. So we have very powerful clients for Android and iOS, for tablets and smartphones, where you can do really everything you can do with the web interface. Again, everything open source, of course. There are desktop clients where it synchronizes your folders, files from your laptop to your server in both directions. And you can click on a file on your desktop and say, I want to share this file and share it with a password or the share should expire. So all the stuff you would expect to work with your files over different devices. So if you then uploaded all your files, then you will also have ways to view your files. There's a PDF viewer that's built in. Again, free software. If you synchronize your photos, then automatically a photo gallery is generated. So if you actually want to share your vacation photos with your friends and family, you can do this from your own little machine, from your Raspberry Pi at home or from your server of your company or some service provider somewhere, wherever you choose. You don't really have to upload all your pictures first to Facebook or to Flickr or something to show it to your family. It's a bit crazy idea. I mean, but a lot of people think it has to be like that. I mean, first I have to give all my data to Facebook, and then I can show the photo to my grandma. That's crazy, right? And here with something like that, it can be like local and decentralized and free. Then, of course, there are many more features like two-factor authentication, where you can use two-factor authentication for your next cloud with like a hardware token or an SMS or some other ways, some push notifications. There's a new feature where we detect also with a neural network suspicious logins. So this is something where you can, the login behavior into your Nextcloud can be tracked, and there's a neural network that's trained. And then if it detects that, strange, this user never logged in, like in the middle of the night from an IP address from China, that's strange. So we can detect that. There's a way to consolidate your data. So if you have other data sources, if you have a network drive, NFS, Samba, S3 storage, or some legacy Dropbox or Google Drive mounts or something, you can always mount everything into your Nextcloud. So you can basically consolidate your data there. The latest version, we also introduced ACLs, access control lists, as an often requested feature from people who still use like a classic file server, like Samba or Windows servers, where we also have like ACL support in Nextcloud now. A full text search, you can find all your files with keywords you've extracted from PDFs and Office files and so on. A very powerful concept is federation, because one of the advantages of Dropbox and Google Drive and all these other services, OneDrive, is that they exist only once, right? They're like run by one company and they exist once. Nextcloud exists like millions of times. So there are millions of Nextcloud servers on this planet. And of course, you have to make sure that they're not isolated islands, that they can actually work together. And for that, we introduced this federation feature where a user, like let's say there's a user here in this Nextcloud, can actually share with a user in that Nextcloud directly, even if they're not on the same machine. So you can have a shared folder with people on different machines. That's quite a powerful concept. Another security feature, I think it's a security conference here after all, is our file access control feature, where as an administrator, you can define rules and policies who can do what. You can say a person from the marketing LDAP group cannot share Excel files over 5 megabytes to an iOS device in the middle of the night to China if it's tagged with VIP or something like that. So you can create these kind of policies. We can really control who can do what. There's also an end-to-end encryption feature, and optionally you can also enable end-to-end encryption. This, of course, has some consequences. For example, the web interface doesn't work anymore if you enable end-to-end encryption for a subfolder. But you can use it for very confidential data. Of course, you shouldn't lose your devices and your passwords and everything, obviously, but it is very secure. Another feature is global scale. So Nextcloud, as I mentioned, runs on a Raspberry Pi at home and also on biggest Linux clusters, obviously. But we also have customers that are a bit bigger. The biggest customer we have has 20 million users. And 20 million users you don't really want to have like in one hosting center or in one database or in one storage, even with a cluster. So for that, we have this global scale architecture where it can also run distributed over different hosting centers. And that's, I'm a bit proud of that because it is exactly the same code that you also run on Raspberry Pi. It's really from very small to very big. There's an integration into Outlook where you can send like big attachments, then they're automatically uploaded to Nextcloud and the link is put into the mail. There's some groupware features, there's a calendar and contacts app, an email frontend, open source Kanban board. So there are lots of features. Most of them are done by the community, by the way. We have a very active community. I'll talk about this later a bit. That's a Kanban board like Trello. Someone might know that. Again, free software and on your own machine. The data is locally wherever you want. And last year, we even introduced some social features. So we are now compatible with the Mastodon distributed social network. There's the same API used, ActivityPub. So a Nextcloud server can also be part of this Fediverse. You can also like exchange social networking messages between a Nextcloud server and your Mastodon server. There's also something called Nextcloud Talk. That's a communication extension. So you can use this to do web meetings and chatting and all kinds of things. You might know this from Slack, for example, or Microsoft Teams or something like that. There's something similar in Nextcloud, where you have like rooms on the side. This can one-on-one conversations or rooms around projects or departments or your family or your soccer club or something, right? And you have a group discussion there. And of course, there are also mobile apps. That's the iOS app. There's also an Android app. Again, free software. Supports push notifications. You get a nice notification. Something happens in a channel. Really similar to Slack and Teams and all the other proprietary centralized competitors, but free software and on your own machine. Of course, you can then drag in files from Nextcloud itself. You can like have files with thumbnails in your chat channel if you want that. And you can press the start call button on the top, and then it transfers into a video call. So we're using WebRTC here, WebRTC as a standard to do audio and video calling from all browsers. It's now supported on Firefox and Chrome, Chromium, Safari, Edge, all major browsers, and everything without a plugin. There's no plugin needed, just normal browser capabilities. It's end-to-end encrypted, does peer-to-peer video communication, and again, everything on your server. And there are also mobile apps, again, iOS and Android. You can also do screen sharing. I can share your screen again. Everything free software without plugins. There's support for bots, so we implemented some bots in the chat where you can like query Wikipedia directly in the chat channel, and there are lots of ways to make this fun. So then, of course, a very important feature that people ask for is document editing, because as you know, we are directly competing with Office 365 and Google Suite, and of course, they have ways to edit documents there. There we implemented an integration with Collabora Online or LibreOffice Online. So that's a system where you can edit Office documents directly in the browser. So you can, in Nextcloud, just click on a file, and then the editor opens, and then you can edit the document. And this is using the LibreOffice engine and the backend, so it's really compatible with most Office formats, even with very weird old ones with macros and everything. That's nice, but of course it becomes really interesting if you do this collaboratively. And for that you can, with the sidebar, invite other people, and then they can go to the same document, and then you have several cursors at the same time working in different places in the same document. Really similar, as you know, from Google Docs or from Office 365. But again, free software on your machine. And the data can stay where it is. One thing that's really bad about Google Docs, for example, is that you always have to import your document first. Then you can do some collaborative editing. And then you have to say, OK, now everybody stop, export it, and put it on your own server again. That's, of course, then you should delete it there, which you then forget. Then you have two versions. So this is not really great. And here is just a normal document you have on your laptop, for example, synchronized to your Nextcloud. Click on it, edit it, and save back to the same document, to the same file. There's no importing, exporting. It's very nice. Of course, if you then edit this document like with five different cursors by five different people, it can be a little bit chaotic. Because of that, it's very nice that we also integrated like Nextcloud Talk in the sidebar. So we have a chat channel and a video call with the people that are editing the same document here. And for this feature, I'm a little bit proud of, because this is nothing Microsoft or Google can do. So it's actually new and innovative. And it's Microsoft, you have Skype for Business, but it's a completely different window than the Word Online. And then, of course, you can put like two browser windows next to each other or something. But this is really nicely integrated here. What I showed you so far is only in the browser. Of course, this also works on mobile. So this is the iOS app, but Android is the same. In this case, on a tablet, where you have your files on the sidebar. You can again click on a Word, Excel, PowerPoint, ODF, ODT file, whatever, and then the editor opens. And again, you can do this collaborative deal with a native app. So this was just a very quick overview over all the features. So I'm very, very happy that we have a very active community. So we have something called an app store. It's not really a store because everything is free, of course. But it's a repository where our community publishes extensions and new things around Nextcloud. And we have over 200 like of those extensions. There's a markdown editor and, I don't know, a vector drawing application, all kinds of things, all kinds of extensions. But everything around on-premise and free software. Okay, so this is what Nextcloud is. And now I want to jump back and talk a little bit about the history, how we get there. So this is the part where I want to talk also a little bit about my personal history. So I'm involved in free software for a long, long time. It started for me personally with the KDE project. So this was really the start of everything for me. I remember when a friend of mine showed me like a beta version of KDE 1.0. I think it was 96 or 97, I'm not really sure. And I looked at it and said, wow, this is awesome. This is super user friendly. This is nice. This is as good as Windows 95, right? So, but it's free. And it's done by this worldwide community of volunteers. It's amazing. Obviously, this will overtake everything. And well, since then, I worked on the idea that next year will be the year of the Linux desktop. Didn't really work out like that. But I was really involved in KDE for a long, long time. Did all kinds of different things, and at the end was a board member, and I really liked the community because it is full with volunteers. It's everything is free software. Everybody's equal. No one takes the big decisions. Everybody can contribute, and together you create something that's really nice. That's of course the same for a lot of other open source communities. I mean, the GNOME project works exactly the same. I was really, really impressed by that. One thing I in many, many discussions, why the Linux desktop didn't happen, one thing I thought a reason could be is that in KDE, we never managed to get, like, we were never able to pay, like, full-time people, full-time work to work on KDE, because it was all volunteers. A lot of students worked on it, but then after their university, like, they got a job and family and everything, and then, of course, they dropped out of the project. And I always thought, what can we do to get like full-time people working on free software? So is there a way to make this happen? This was always something I tried to make somehow. Then in 2010, I founded OwnCloud with the mission, as I just described earlier. The idea is to have an HGPL-licensed free software alternative to these cloud services. And of course, I did this basically inspired what I learned from the KDE community. So it was like everything was open. There was, I think it was started even with a Subversion repository, but then Git, of course, later. But everybody was equal. There was a mailing list. Everybody could discuss everything and contribute. And it was nicely growing, released several versions, did the first developer meetings, and really got some momentum. I think this was also the time where I was like invited here to present OwnCloud at the time at this nice conference here. But then again, the question was for me, okay, can we, this is nice, but I'm not really sure if this is, if like that, we can really go against Google and Microsoft and the other big guys. I mean, there's a lot of power in the volunteer community, but to really conquer and really like go against the big guys, we have to take a step up. Basically, I want to be able to pay people to work on this software. But Well, then people basically approached us, or me and the rest of the community already, and said, hey, can I buy support for that? I'm already using this in my company. Can I support you somehow? I need a feature. Who can develop the feature? So it was always like, okay, maybe there is something there. And then end of 2011, I got in contact with two other people who are like involved in open source business already. And because at the time I thought I can't do this alone, and together we decided, okay, let's try to take OwnCloud as an open source project and turn it into a company. Or not turn it into a company, but found a company additionally to it, basically, with an open source business model, and to make some money, to grow and support the product development. So this was the idea. And the three of us founded then this company. One guy took the position of the CEO, the other sales and marketing, and I was the CTO at the time. So this was founded in the end of 2011. I was told by my founding partners that you have to do this in the US because only in the US you know how you can do software. I mean, Europe can do other things, but software is really US. And also, like in the US, you have the great venture capital companies who really give you a lot of money, and then everything is great. Of course, if you do that, then you're basically already on track. You're already part of the venture capital system, because this is not like free money. That's an investment, and they want to take the money back, of course, obviously. Usually, they want to take like 10x of the money back. So if someone gives you $1 million, which is actually quite easy nowadays, it's venture capital, you can really get money. Money quite easily. The only thing you have to do is you have to explain them how you can pay $10 million back in 3 years. And then you get $1 million. It's not a big of a problem. Of course, how can you pay like $10 million back in 3 years? That's quite hard. The only way is you have a product which is like immensely profitable, which is basically never the case, or you basically do the next investment round after that. So you have the round after round, and maybe like an IPO or the big exit or something. But yeah, you're part of the system then, right? You're not in control of your destiny anymore. But I then didn't really realize this at the time. Of course, then if you get like this big investment, this big money investment, and OwnCloud over time got $10 million investment in 3 rounds. This is nothing. They don't want you to take the money to the bank and like spend it wisely, right? You have to spend it like fast, because this is all about fast growth, right? So if you can't grow fast, then they prefer to not do it at all. It's not about like, yeah, building something up and then maybe in 20 years or something you have something. That's not how it works. You get the money now, you have to spend the money now. And how can you spend so much money? Yet we hire people, but then you have to hire like a lot of people who are also not very familiar with open source and free software, and that's what we did. So we had a lot of like management at the time who really had no idea about what open source really is. They were really like, oh, it's just another software company. But what is this community thing, and what do you mean? You give it away for free, and that was really a lot of discussions, a lot of fun meetings. My friends from KDE were skeptical. Hey, Frank, do you know what you're doing? I thought, yes, this will be great. at the end, they were right. And of course, then some issues popped up with this setup. The management and the investors and the community just had like different ideas where things are going. And by the way, I'm not saying that venture capital or the classic startup thing is a bad thing. I mean, if everybody agrees on this is how we do it, then it can be fine. Just in our case, we had this huge community of volunteers, and we had this like core people, including me. We were like idealists, right? This is not about like selling to Google next year. It's about something that really everybody can use. And if we have this bad alignment, then that's a problem, of course. So the question is, do you want to have sustainability or quick money? There was some tension then. The company people didn't really understand this community people. Some community people were unhappy about some things and left the project already. Saying what is going on here? There are some decisions done behind closed doors. We don't really like that, and it's going into a weird direction, so we don't like it. So core people left the project. And of course, there were some other mismanagement, just as you expect if you have a lot of new people throwing together into a room and say, now make a company. There's a lot of ton of mistakes. The business model at the time was, this might be interesting, was several things. First of all, dual licensing. So OwnCloud at the time was available under two licenses, was the HEPL, but then also a separate license, like a commercial proprietary license. Because what customer has been told was like, okay, you can have the product under the HEPL, but this means that if you do any change, you have to open source your change. That's a requirement of these licenses. But if you don't want to do that, no problem. We can sell you this other license, and then you don't have to do that, but you have to pay us money for that. And of course, this is only possible if the company owns the copyright on all the code. So we had to introduce a copyright license agreement, contributor agreement, where basically everybody who contributed software to OwnCloud had to transfer the ownership to the company. So you see this sometimes in open source companies. Then a second thing to make money was OpenCore Enterprise Edition. It's basically the idea that, yeah, there is OwnCloud, and it has some features, but if you really want to have all the features, you have to get this other version, which is not open source. It's just normal proprietary software. You just pay money and you get the software, and if you stop paying money, you can't use the software anymore, just normal proprietary software business, which has all the features. And the open source version is some kind of trial or light version of the product. The contributor agreement already mentioned that. And of course, this really created a lot of conflict. I can talk about this in a second. So one thing is that in product management, then volunteers, they usually do what they want, right? I mean, if you tell them what to do, then this is not fun and no longer volunteering, right? So this is just how it works. And they do what they want, which is great. Because a lot of open source contributors are quite clever, intelligent people, right? They have like great ideas. And you can look at a lot of open source projects, GNOME, KDE, many others, where these contributors have great ideas to improve the product. But for classic product management, where if you're a product manager and really decides about a roadmap, that's of course a bit of a problem. Then in the last minute, there's a weird new feature popping up in a release. And where does this come from? This wasn't discussed in the last meeting. And so that's a bit of a conflict there. Then the next problem was at the time that we had these great enterprise features in the enterprise edition, and they're not in the community edition, they're not open source. And then, of course, the community started to re-implement the enterprise features. And then the company said, yeah, no, we're not really merging that because that's against our interest. And then, of course, if you create a conflict like that between the community in the company, then this is no longer working. So this really created a lot of frustration. Also, the investors were not really happy. The overall mindset, how the product should go, was not really synchronized. An example was the market. So I don't know how many know Gartner. It's one of those IT analyst companies. They usually define markets and magic quadrants. They say, yeah, this is the groupware market, and this is the whatever market. And at the time, they basically created this enterprise file sync and share market, and OwnCloud was in this market. So this is an enterprise file sync and share product. And all investor discussions, yes, we are doing this enterprise file sync and share software. This is what we're doing. But of course, the community doesn't really care. Right? They just do what they like. For example, they implemented a calendar. So OwnCloud has a quite nice calendar and contacts management. But then, of course, everybody was really confused, like, what is that? That's groupware. That's different. So you can't mix that. That's a crazy idea. So this is just this kind of mindset, which was not really, really in line. So at the end of 2016, the situation was that the contributor community was unhappy. The employees were unhappy because most of them were the developers at least, friends of mine, who I brought into a company, said, hey, you can, this is great, you can work on free software and together with the community. And in reality, they had to write like proprietary closed source features, which I didn't like. And the customers were also not happy, because in the public marketing, everybody thought, yeah, OwnCloud is open source. And then if you go to companies, they can buy support for this open source product. Sure, but first you have to buy this proprietary product here. So that's, again, the customers were confused by then. So I had, I don't know, countless meetings where I tried to steer this into the better direction, but I failed. At the end of the day, also like this overall misalignment led into financial troubles for the company. So, like I said, we burned 10 million, and I don't, yeah, it's weird. I don't know. I mean, you can imagine what you can do with 10 million, and I don't know what really happens there. I don't know. Yeah, at some point there was the discussion, yeah, we really need more customers, and then, yeah, okay, let's invest like huge amount of money into LinkedIn advertising. Okay, and then there was the money. Okay, so situation 2015, 2016 was basically that this was failing, this was not working. If this would have been a normal proprietary software company, then everything would just be shut down. The software would be lost or would be owned by the bank or I don't know, and the customers would lose their solution and go to the competitor or something. But of course, the core, like the 80% or something of OwnCloud was still open source, HGPL license, and the community really liked the idea and the product was not bad. There was the opportunity to fork that. And this then led to the Nextcloud fork. So this was quite an adventure. So in May 2016, so 3 years ago, the 12 core people, including me, left OwnCloud then and founded Nextcloud, like a new project with a new name and also a little bit later with a new company with a better business model. Because we thought, there are so many obviously mistakes, we can do this better. So the first thing we did was we all met in Stuttgart in Germany, like for a week, we in a house which was available, and we all sat there for 1 week and did a lot of brainstorming, thinking about, okay, so what can we do? How did it work in the past? What was good? What was bad? How would be a fair business model work? How would be the rules in a company would be to have it really like fair and everything? And after this week, we came up with a list of some principles. So first of all, we wanted to do Nextcloud in a sustainable way. So because of that, we don't want to have any external investment, because external investors always have the expectation to like do the big exit or something, and that doesn't fit together with sustainability. Sustainability means, like in our case, that the core team, everybody really likes, we really like the work, and we want to do the same in the next 20, 30 years. There's no interest in a big exit, so no external investment. Second is we want to do everything free software and open source, so we don't really want to do this proprietary, mixed, weird licensing anymore. We also don't want to force our contributor to sign any contract, to transfer any ownership. That's not needed. I mean, if you look at the Linux kernel or KDE or Apache or many other of those projects, you have shared ownership, right? Every contributor owns their contribution. And then we all, or the community together, agrees on a license, like GPL in case of the Linux kernel, or KDE in our case, HGPL. But this is then the deal. But the copyright is owned by the contributor, but overall it's available for everybody under this one license. And this is how I also want to do that. We don't want to force our community to sign any contracts. We, as a company, also don't want to own any code. It's not needed. It's not needed in the free software world. We want to use open standards as much as possible. We want to do everything federated and decentralized, as I showed earlier. We want to do everything in the open. We don't want to have any internal meetings. We want to invite the community into every discussion. And we also want to have a diverse community. So diversity is very important. Okay, so this is all very nice, but of course the question is how do we actually then pay the people? How does this work? So what is the business model of what we are doing? And it's not really that hard. I mean, you can just look at how the successful open source companies do it. I mean, just look at what Red Hat, which is the biggest open source company, how they do it, and how SUSE is doing it. And we do exactly the same, which means we sell an enterprise subscription to big companies, which is then support and certification and training and security fixes and so on, and workshops and everything they need to basically run it like in a mission critical environment. And with that, we focus on very big customers. So it's really similar to RHEL and CentOS and Fedora. I mean, everybody can download Fedora, and it's nice. Also, a lot of companies use it, of course. But if you really want to run it in a mission-critical way, if you're a bank or if you're a big organization and really want to have support and want to have like long-term support also, and you want to have make sure that it's like properly tested and everything, you might invest the money into a Red Hat subscription. And that's exactly the same for us. So that's exactly the same way we're doing that. As a part of the subscription, you get support and security consulting, scalability help. We can help you with branding of the software. If you need us and need a feature, we can develop the feature to, with you in part of a project. So this is basically our business model. So how is it going? So how is it? Does it look today? I'm actually happy. I'm more than happy that it's all worked out quite nicely. It was quite an adventure, to be honest. But now we are in really good shape. So we have more contributors than ever. So we have over 2,000 code contributors, over 2,000 code contributors in the last release. And this is growing nicely, more than ever before. As a company, we are able to pay 45 people full-time to work on Nextcloud. I would say they're like 50-60% development. And the rest is just the usual sales and marketing and administration. So we are a small, little software company, but fully working with free software. We are profitable, so we don't make a lot of profit, but it's like we are stable, growing, so that we can hire more people over time. And we don't have any external investment, so we don't have any, no one comes to the core group and say, hey, you really should, I don't know, grow 10 times in the next 6 months or something. That's not happening. And we have a nice customer base. So it's also a good time at the moment. I mean, a lot of people are concerned about GDPR and data security and centralization of IT. And I mean, you just see the latest news from Huawei and the US companies. I mean, this is just there's a lot of tension about centralized services, and we can provide an alternative to decentralize things a little bit more. We don't have this contributor agreement. Everything we're doing is free software. We are really fast with our releases. I was surprised when we announced the Nextcloud fork, only 2 weeks after that, there was already the first release out. So this was faster than what I thought, but the community was like, oh, that's great, finally, and then copied everything and replaced trademark and logos and everything, and just 2 weeks documentation was all like redone, and 2 weeks later it was all like the first release was out. I go, wow, that's really fast. All pull requests. The pull requests are the way we do our feature development. They're all equal. So if you follow the pull request on GitHub, it doesn't make a difference if like a feature comes from an employee or from a volunteer. It's just all the same process. They have to pass the automation, the integration, the unit tests. And if this is all okay, then the feature is in. There's no veto from a company or something. We do crazy stuff, like even our website is on GitHub, and people contribute to our company website with pull requests. Actually, the design of our company website, which I think is quite nice, comes from a volunteer. So someone decided, hey, why not, this is Nextcloud is nice, let me just like help you with the design of the website. So this is quite unusual, but yeah, if you have a really happy community, it's really, it's working. So this is the meeting, this is the photo of the last meeting, this is the Nextcloud conference. We do like once a year in Berlin a conference, this is from last year where we had over 200 people there. So over 200 people spent their free time to come to this event for a week to work on Nextcloud for fun. Of course, there are also some challenges. I would say the biggest challenge is the trademark, because we were able to take the code and build on top of the code. And also, I mean, I knew a lot of customers who then switched to us, and a lot of things were relatively easy. But the trademark, the name, even like I came up with the name OwnCloud, and my wife did the logo and everything. Of course, it was then owned by the company and no longer by me. So we couldn't use the old name. So we had to create a new name, Nextcloud. And you know how it is. If you establish a new brand, it takes some time until it's like fully like in the wild. And you can see this with OpenOffice and LibreOffice too, right? I mean, I'm fighting for so long. And I still hear from people who say, yeah, I just downloaded the latest OpenOffice, and it's great. And then I say, don't do that. That's a dead project. Use LibreOffice instead. But I have just like OpenOffice is so still in their head. So this is Google Trends. This is a tool where you can see the how often a term is used on the internet, basically. And you can see the red one is OwnCloud and the blue is Nextcloud. So we have overtaken them in popularity. I think nowadays by over double the popularity. But they're still there, right? And it takes another, I don't know, 5 years or 10 years until like really every one of those people understand that Nextcloud is the future. But yeah, we have to, that takes time. And from a customer side, we're really happy. For example, there's a German government who is using Nextcloud now for all the federal ministries. There's companies like Siemens and German Television and many others. So they're quite happy that that these big organizations use our Nextcloud subscription, enterprise subscription, and this is how we pay our people. So the summary is, we want to be an alternative to Dropbox, to Google Suite, and Office 365, because all those services are centralized, as I showed in the beginning. And I really think we should decentralize that. And I think it can be done with self-hosting and with free software. And this is what we try to do together with the community. So Nextcloud has the difference that it's self-hosted, 100% open source, and distributed and federated. And yeah, if you're interested, I mean, just go to the website, download it for free, play around with it, and all you, of course, can also get involved in the community. So thanks a lot.
We have a microphone, so if you have a question, please raise your hand.
First of all, thank you. We use it in our company, and it's absolutely crucial for us.
Oh, great.
So thank you very much. You mentioned there are millions of installs. Do you have statistics on active?
No? No, this is one of the problems. If it's decentralization, right? We don't have any real data. We don't know how many users and instances and so on. There is a feature in Nextcloud where it checks for a new version. It can check if there's a new version available. So we have an update server where you can provide like an XML file, and then it's fetched to check if there's a new version. And there, with a little bit of statistics, we can assume that there are millions of instances. There are a lot of requests from unique IP addresses, but we don't really know. No.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So, probably like you, I really worry about cloud services because they're proprietary. I think this is a great alternative in being distributed, but I wonder, since you mentioned customers like the German government, where the storage itself, do they all self-host and then store terabytes on still traditional storage, or do they use cloud storage services behind it?
Yeah, so there are many, many different options. I mean, in the case of the German government, they have their own internal service provider, basically, and they have like three big hosting centers, and they store everything in a network which is not connected to the internet, and they invest a lot into infrastructure. There are, of course, like others who use service providers. So if you go to nextcloud.com/providers, you can see over 100 service providers who offer Nextcloud hosting. Some use those. And that's, I think, okay, you might ask, okay, why is this better than using Google? I think there are a few things that are better. First of all, there's not only one. I mean, if there are like 10,000 service providers where you can choose instead of one, that's an improvement. I mean, ideally, everybody has a server at home, but I don't know if it's realistic, but already have like many, many service providers is already better. And you can choose, you can switch between them, of course. Some bigger companies, they use public clouds, but there is a way to encrypt it, for example. So there's a feature in Nextcloud where you can run a Nextcloud server locally, but then it mounts like an S3 storage, maybe. For example, or Azure works the same, and it's like encrypted on the server, and on Amazon is only encrypted data. So that's a way to run it. Or they just choose a service provider which is like certified. Maybe they have a special service provider next door which is like certified, and they have a service level agreement they like, and the data is like local, so it's in the European Union, and this is also sometimes used. But there are a lot of different options.
First of all, thank you for the very interesting talk. Quick question about marketing. I'm a developer myself, but it seems strange to ask something about marketing. I was in the Brussels airport the other day, and I saw a huge advertisement by Google. How do you intend to tackle these 9,000-pound blue whale companies with their marketing budgets?
I don't know. Tell me.
Yeah, it's a thorny problem because these are very important decentralized services, and people are sitting around in the airports. It's kind of if only can manage something
it's
like that.
It's a big challenge. That's a big challenge. If you go back to this slide, it's of course a bit cheating, right? Because if I would like put like Dropbox and Google in there, it would be like I don't know, 5 kilometers higher than that. So that's a challenge. I don't know. I mean, our strategy is to do it more like grassroots, of course, more viral. I mean, that's the only chance we have. But I don't know if it's good enough. I hope so. If you have any ideas.
Surprised I've never heard of this before, but it's a fantastic product and I'm very interested. A question about the federation. Obviously, if you don't federate, it's your own environment and no one else can access it, etc. If you do federate, does it make it effectively like Google or what have you, that you have access to users of every other federated system? Is that one big cloud, literally?
So the federation feature works user-based, which means I, as a user, log into one Nextcloud server, and then I can see my files and folders, and I can click on them and say, I want to share this with another person, and I can say, share it with another person on the same machine, or create a link and send this link by mail to someone or by chat, and I click on the link and have the file or the folder. But I can also say, I want to share this file or folder with someone on a different machine. And we use this username at other server URL as an identifier. So if, I don't know, you tell me that I'm using this Nextcloud and this is my username, similar to email, I type in share this with blah, 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 blah. And then my server contacts your server and say, hey, I have a share request from Frank of this folder to you. You can say yes or no. If you say yes, then it appears in your home directory.
And are the other federated services also searchable from my server?
Searchable?
So, like, so, search for other users or people I know on other servers.
Yeah, so this is was the easy part so far. Discoverability is the big challenge, of course, right? Because like in Google, you get like your friends automatically recommended because they're reading your email, so they already know your friends and everything, right? So easy. So easy for them, right? But for us, you have a blinking cursor there, and I have to know your server address, otherwise it doesn't work, right? So we have some ideas about discoverability. So if some servers trust each other, we can configure them as trusted servers. For example, if different universities say, yeah, we trust each other, then these servers can exchange address books in the background, and then you have auto-completion of users on remote servers. But this requires trust relationship. Then there is a second way, like a lookup server. We have a lookup server available where a user in the settings page can say, I want to be found or not. It's basically like a telephone book, right? If you get a new mobile phone, you have a phone number and no one knows the phone number, no one can call you. You can give the phone number to your friends and they can call you. Or you say, I want to be in the public telephone book, and then people can look up your name. So we have the same. So we can say, I want to be found, and then I can actually auto-complete you, can find your server because you're in the telephone book.
Hi, I wonder, OwnCloud being owned by US lawyers, could you just fork the codes, or did you run into any copyright ownership challenges? Any lessons learned there?
So what do you mean with fork the?
No. Could you just fork the code?
Yeah, we forked the code.
So without any.
No. It's HGPL software. You can, it's legal. The only thing we couldn't fork is like the trademark. So we had to pick a new name. But the code, that's what we did. So on day one, when Nextcloud was founded, the code was 100% the same. Of course, nowadays we move forward higher speed than before, so it's a lot different. But at the time, it was a perfect copy. Yeah.
So no lawyers trying to follow you?
So there's, of course, a little bit more that maybe without a video camera. So, not everybody was happy about our move. So, and some people tried to stop us unsuccessfully. But there were some lawyers made some money. Yeah, but that's solved, and because doing a fork like that is perfectly legal, right? It's like totally fine.
So what are the lessons learned then? What should I do when I do fork my company?
First of all, I would try to avoid it. It was not, I mean, now I'm standing here and I have a success story, but I mean, it was many months, not a lot of fun, right? But I would say if you have an open source project, I mean, the software, we as a free software community, we mainly care about who owns the license, right? We care about the licenses, and they are important. But my advice would be also think about who owns the name and who owns maybe the shares of a company, if there's a company, and other things. Right? Let's not focus too much on licenses, fighting GPL v2 versus v3. I mean, it's all valid, but also think about other things, right? Who is in control of other assets. That would be my advice.
Hi, I use Nextcloud. I have two installations, but that's not what the question was about. You mentioned diversity being important to you. Mm-hmm. How are you doing on that part?
Not good.
Yeah, most guys are geeks. Or geeks are guys.
So I think in the company we have like 5 women at the moment. From 45 people, that's not good enough. We are doing internships, active internships, where we basically look for women or other people with different cultural backgrounds. We founded last fall an initiative called Nextcloud Include, where luckily we won an innovation prize last year, 20,000 euros, and we put this 20,000 euros into this diversity fund. And for this 20,000 euros, we like do internships and mentoring and fly people into conferences to like directly try to improve diversity. But it's still a long way to go.
Thank you.
Hey, we have room for one more question. I had one there. And we can have more questions in the break that's directly after this presentation.
So a few years ago, Oracle bought MySQL, and that was not that great. how do you, being just one company in that community, actually, how do you just take measures that doesn't happen to your systems? Just not sell? That will help, of course?
Yeah, I mean, of course. I mean, I said a few times already we are not selling, but of course, I don't know, you have to trust me or the other core people. But I mean, it's also, there's a few other things to protect against it. First of all, if someone would buy the Nextcloud company, what would they really buy, right? Because they're not buying code or anything, because it's not owned by the company. So the company has inherently relatively less value. I mean, there is the name, of course. I've been in the process of transferring this into a foundation to make it like independent with a kill switch there, where then the foundation could then like basically take away the right from the company to use the trademark. I don't want to go into too much details, but we're trying to protect against that in that scenario, and also. We are also not super profitable. I mean, we are stable and we are growing, but we are not like, this is not like a big opportunity to buy this company. We are like stable. And to be honest, also because of the core people who work there, if someone would buy the company and then everybody would quit, then there's nothing you own, right? So so I don't know, I don't think it's going to happen, not with our setup, because everything is set up in a way that we don't want to do that.